Hi, I'm Dakota Prey with the Division of Wildlife. I'm the conservation officer for Rich County. Today we got a deer in front of us. I'm going to show you how to take it from ground right after you've harvested your animal to skinned, quartered, to cut up into roast steaks and which cuts. I'm going to explain each step throughout the whole process and hopefully you learn something from it. So first things first, obviously you can see this deer has already it's shot, it's been gutted. You can see it's pretty clean on the inside. The goal when I gut an animal is I just want to get the stuff that's inside out as fast as I can. A lot of people take a long time, be really meticulous. Once you've done it a few times, you just realize that really you just have to cut up the stomach, cut through the rib cage if you'd like, not necessary, and just get the stuff that's in there out as quick as you can. The gutting the animal intimidates a lot of people. And all you really need to do is, like I said, just get everything inside out. So once that's done, depending how you want to bring it out, if you're close enough to your vehicle, you'll just drag it out as is and you'll do the skinning process at home. But I'll kind of explain the skinning method, the gutting method, or the quartering out method, and we'll go from there. So the first cuts I like to make is once it's been gutted up through here, I cut right around the joints of the deer to kind of get it working so you can take the skin off. So there's all sorts of different tools you can use gutting a deer. You know, there's the gut hooks, just straight knife. A lot of people bring a saw in. I can gut a deer with just a straight single pocket knife, cutting the joints off, skinning the whole deer, cutting through the rib cage. I'll show you the soft little cartilage spot you can go through a little bit later. But you can do the whole process with just a knife. Gut hooks, skinning hooks, something like this help. But you can do the whole process with a knife. So I'll show you kind of the first steps just with a knife, then I'll show you how to do it with a gut hook. Got to come around to the front here. So what you need to do is you just got to get under the skin a little bit. You can stick your knife right in there in the tip, kind of lead it with your finger, and you pretty much just unzip it. You can see how smooth that came back. Just peel it back and you work your way around. And then at that point, it's just working the whole hide off. So the next step I'm going to show you is skinning. I'll just skin the other leg like I did with the knife, but I'm going to use the gut hook, the skinning hook, whatever you'd like to call it. That one's pretty simple. All you need to do is you just stick it under the skin and you just pull it like you would a zipper on a shirt. You can see how smooth that goes. Makes it real nice and easy. Just one of the tools you can use while doing it. So what I'm doing here is as I'm skinning it, I'm just pulling back the hide enough to kind of expose that soft skin that's holding the hide to the meat. And all you got to do is you don't really have to cut it, you just kind of have to touch it with your knife. It's really thin stuff and it comes off pretty easy. come up to the front legs and do the same to the front. And all you really need to do is you're cutting from the inside here, just straight down to wherever your cut is, just so you can get the hide off. So one of the things I want to talk about just while I'm skinning this, if you can pack out the deer whole, you can read all different things on, you know, if you should leave the hide on, if you should take the hide off. Once you get it home and you have it hanging, if you can leave it whole. My personal feelings on it is if you can leave the hide on and hang it in your garage, what you're going to do is you're going to protect the meat for a longer amount of time. So one of the downfalls to skinning it is the meat starts to dry out. You'll get that outer quarter inch of meat all the way around the deer. You know, if you have a 3-inch backstrap, you're going to lose a quarter to a half an inch of just the meat drying out, not being able to be used as good because it's dry. So I'm a fan of, if you can, pack it out whole, if you're close enough to your truck, and use the hide as kind of a protector for the meat. I find that I have more meat to use if I do it that way. All right. Some ice crystals. All right, that's probably good on that side. So the times I would skin an animal, going back to, if you can leave the skin on, take it off. A lot of people like to take it off, and one of the best advantages is to cool it down faster. If you got, you know, hot summer months, early archery season, that's when I'd recommend to cut the skin off and let that animal that you just harvested cool down as fast as you can. When I get my animal, if I can get it later in the year when it's a little bit cooler, I like to leave it hanging as long as I can. Some people, you know, they'll shoot it, they'll cut it up into steaks and roasts that night within the next day or so. For me, I like to let my animal hang as long as I can get away with, really. Kind of my telltale sign on if it's time to cut an animal up, if, you know, the weather's permitting, is when it's hanging in the garage, I'll have that chest cavity propped open, and when there's little specks of, I guess you could call it mold, just little tiny specks on the inside of the rib cage, that's when it kind of tells me the deer's ready. That's when I'll come forward and I'll skin the animal and process, you know, within the day. That's just kind of my personal thing. I've always had good experience with the meat turning out really good at that point. But definitely if you're a ways back into the backcountry, you know, you're not too close to the truck, skinning is going to take a lot of weight off your pack. You'll be able to get back to the truck faster, get your animal cooled down faster. It is really beneficial. That's why I say, you know, if you can't leave the skin on, it's okay to take it off too. That's just kind of my personal reasoning. Come around. Let's get into this. So to go on with, you know, packing the animal out, leaving skin on, skin off, a lot of people, what's getting more popular nowadays is the gutless method, where people like to take their animal out without ever even cutting the stomach open. It's a piece of cake, and I'll show you some cool tricks. So all you need to do at that point is skin it almost like we have, you know, start down low, take it off this way. I like to do one side at a time. We're all skinning the entire one side of the animal and then take it off piece by piece. When we get a little bit deeper into it, I'll go through and kind of explain which pieces I take first and why. And then what a lot of people do, their biggest mistake on the gutless method is right inside of the chest cavity. That's where your tenderloins are from. And you don't want to leave those behind. They're one of the best parts. And you can actually get your tenderloins from coming in through the back after you've taken the back strap off to get those tenderloins out of pretty much any animal without ever even having to open the guts. So you can do the gutless method and leave with your tenderloins, which is pretty important in my book. They're one of the tastier cuts of the deer. So for me, I'm a fan of taking as much as you possibly can from a deer. You know, what I recommend is taking at least the four quarters. Even if one's shot, you want to make sure you bring all four quarters out, just to, you know, if you get checked by an officer, you want to be able to show that it was shot. You don't want to have to hike back into where you're going to take it out. But a lot of people just take the four quarters and call it good. Makes me cringe. One of the best parts of the deer is the neck meat. A lot of people skip over it. For this doe that we have here, the neck meat's pretty small, but you know, you get a good size elk, cow elk, bull elk, whichever really, there's some really good roasts. Some of the more tender cuts of meat are in that neck roast. I'll go through and show you how to take out that neck roast today. It's just as easy as taking out a back strap, and it's tasty. I'm even a fan of, you know, when I get an animal, if I want to do, it's hard to say, because if I want to do the gutless method, I'm going to end up gutting it anyways, because I take everything. I'll take all the shoulders, obviously. I'll take the tenderloin. I'll take the meat, the neck. But I love deer ribs and elk ribs. Not many people try them. They kind of get a bad rep. When you cook them, they smell super, super gamey. But when you go to eat them, they're delicious. So I'll show you how to take the ribs off as well. But I have a hard time doing the gutless method because I pretty much take the entire carcass when I harvest my animal. So what's hard to see while I'm skinning the deer, you may have been able to tell, when I'm taking the skin off, you don't have to put much pressure on your knife. You know, you don't have to be squeezing the knife solid and hard. All I'm really doing is it's just kind of sitting in my hand, and as I'm pulling, I'm just kind of touching that soft skin that's between the meat and the hide. Just kind of barely touching it, just to kind of peel it away. The more strength I'm using is on the muscle holding the hide. I'm more pulling the hide away, and then just kind of touching it with the blade to kind of break that free. So if I was at home, what I'd do here is I'd probably have the deer hanging, is how I prefer to work on it. And I would skin the other side, but since we're here, I want to show you guys kind of how to quarter out your animal. if you're up on the mountains doing the boneless method even. So I said earlier that you want to get half the deer skinned. So we've done that. The next goal is to take everything on this side off. Some are easier than other sides, but we'll go through each step on taking that off. So I'll just finish getting the legs off. You kind of just have to find the joint, and you can take it off just with a knife. You just take the knife right to the joint. I mean, like I said earlier, a lot of people use saws, and that's fine if you do. Not necessary exactly though. You can do everything on a deer that you possibly need to do with just a knife like that. And I've got a lot of other knives. We'll go through those later, but this is like a Walmart special knife. It's like a couple bucks. So it's something that anybody can buy, just throw in their pack. Get a new one every season. They're pretty sharp, and I found them to be pretty good knives. So when you're taking the front shoulder off, it's not really attached by any bone. So all you really need to do is come underneath. Like I said, I'm not really holding the knife too hard. I'm just separating from that. You can kind of see there's just kind of a pocket underneath there. I'll cut straight through right here to leave as much onto this neck meat as I can. If it's not good enough on this one, we can always save this to the side for a hamburger. But as you can see, I'm just softly pulling this off. To remove the leg. I'll go right along the top of the paddle bone, and it comes off just like that. I'll set this aside to go through a little bit later. And that one for packing out, on most animals you can leave the paddle bone in and not even care about, you know, boning that one out. If you need to, it's as simple as cutting the steaks off the cuts off. We'll go through that in a little bit. So when you're taking this back hind quarter off, you'll go right through this pelvic bone and try to keep your knife, the meat on this one sticks really hard to the bone, so you want to try to keep your knife, the tip of the knife, the blade of the knife, against the bone as much as you can. You are going to cut some of the meat. A lot of people go really slow trying to be as meticulous, but overall you're going to cut a little bit of the meat that's going to stick to the bone. Just as long as you keep that knife tip against the bone as tight as you can, that's kind of the ultimate goal on this one. So as you can see, I just stayed right against the bone. You can see a few spots where I nicked the meat a little bit, and that's fine. Given the location of this one, there's really no way around it. So when you're cutting up an animal, obviously you've just shot it. There's gonna be some bruising from where it was shot. So the bloodshot stuff, the bruising, that's some of the stuff that gives a deer a bad name. It's extremely gamey, and it's something I don't like to keep in the meat. So as you can see right here, this deer was shot for depredation purposes somewhere in the central region. Looks like it was hit right here just based on the injury right here. And so I'm just gonna cut this piece clean off. This is something normally I would leave on for ribs, have a little bit of more meat on the ribs. But with the bloodshot, I just don't want to mess with it. I want to try to get it off and try to keep it as clean and as good as I can. So you can see the entry was likely right here and just some blood pooling. And that's the stuff that's going to make the meat taste bad. I like to just completely remove it. There will be some underneath even where the ribs are, and we'll just cut those out when we get down to the ribs. So I just clean cut it off. So there's certain cuts that a lot of people just cut off and use for just use for grind, pretty much. I like to find a use for every cut. If I need hamburger, I can always use some extra roasts, but there's certain cuts that are kind of fun to work with, fun to cook with. This one right here along the chest, I like to cut that one off. It's pretty thin, has pretty good marbling through the inside. I'll cut it off, we'll trim it up later. I'm actually going to cut that up and cook fajitas with it. But I don't like to let any part of the animal that I take stay on the ground. Like I said, I'd even take the ribs. So, okay, so we'll get to the good stuff now. So we're gonna take the back straps off of this deer now. Working, you know, halfway on the side. So, interesting thing, you know, just for information, people call this just the back strap. So what it is, if you want to break it down beef-wise, this is your ribeye steaks and your New York steaks, and sirloin steaks towards this back end. So the ribeye start as soon as the neck ends, the chuck area ends. You'll get, you know, half that back strap is going to be your ribeyes. The next half is going to be your New York type cuts, and then you're going to finish off with the sirloins. The sirloins will also be kind of in that hind quarter, that butt portion. All right, so what we're going to do next on this deer is we're going to take the back straps off. It's everybody's favorite part of the deer is the back straps, the steaks. That's important stuff to a lot of people. So what you want to do is you want to go back against this backbone. You'll just stick the knife right in, angle it so it kind of stays against that bone, and just kind of cut it down. And what you want to do is you just want to keep it against that bone as much as you can. You can see where the white dots of the bone are, and you just want to hug that as tight as you can to leave as much meat in on the actual back strap and off the bone as you can. And you'll feel, just kind of let your knife do its job, feel against the bone and let your knife follow the contour. You know, don't force it too much one way or the other. Just kind of let your knife do its job. On most of these cuts that I'm doing, I don't use much pressure on my knife, just to hold on. So I like to make my first cut there, and a lot of people will cut straight through here and peel it back. I like to go back on this top side and work against the ribs so I can have a backboard to cut the meat off. What a lot of people do is they'll leave, you know, a pretty good sized triangular shaped strip all the way down the animal, because once they get to here, they just kind of turn their knife in and guess. I like to come back up to the top so I can use the ribs as a backboard the whole time I'm cutting. Because I'll go through and, I mean, you can see the ribs. I'll just take my knife and keep my knife against those ribs the whole time. And like I was saying, when you're on the other side, just let your knife do its job. keep it against the ribs. You know, don't force it where it doesn't need to be cutting. Just let it follow where it needs to follow. Then eventually you can get through and you can see how I've gone all the way around that loin and very little meat's left on the ribs. Now it does come to a point kind of at the top of the neck, kind of where the neck meets the chest, where you will just want to cut it straight through, because that's when you're going to cut this and use this as your neck roasts, your meat from the neck. So I'll just do that right here. A lot of people are a little afraid of cutting straight through a cut, but if you know where you can cut straight through, it takes all that and takes the guesswork out of things. I'll keep working against the backbone, keeping my knife against the bone more than anything. If I cut the bone, I don't care. I just don't want to cut through the meat. So you can see, I've already got a good chunk of that off. Now that I've got that off, I'll just kind of peel it back. Won't really pull it, I'll just kind of hold it and let the weight of the meat do the job. And I'll just work my way back through here. So on the gutless method, you'd be doing this the exact same, taking this off. And I like to leave the hide laying down, just because if this piece of meat does fall down, it's not laying in the dirt now. It's sitting on the hide, kind of just acts as a tablecloth, if you will. Gives another layer of protection to the meat to keep it as clean as you can for as long as you can. And here in a second, I'll show you on this side how to get the tenderloin out. Doing the gutless method once you get the loin off. A lot of people leave those behind. But you don't want to, it's a tasty cut. So once you get back to this bone, your goal is to get it off. It's kind of hard to work under there, so a thin knife is always good. But once you do, you can see I've left that pretty clean. There's a little bit of meat left back here, but really not too bad. And you got yourself a whole deer loin you can work with. Said earlier, you got this front half that's your ribeye type, this back half that's your New York type. Kind of a cool way to look at it. A lot of people just look at a deer and they say, okay, steaks, roasts, that's all you got. But today I'm going to show you, what it equivalates onto a beef cow. So right here's your ribeye. This side's going to be your New York. I'll show you where to cut those up a little bit later. So for this next one, I'm going to show you how to take the tenderloin out. So you got to imagine this animal's still full. So the belly will be tight. That tenderloin is laying right here on this strip. You can kind of find it because this last rib right here, where it comes down and ends, you got four or five ribs right here that they're just part of the vertebrae. They don't have ribs attached. So what you want to do is you'll just kind of cut against those. Then if this is still tight, you just kind of work your knife through this really softly until you get into that stomach cavity. And then you'll just work your hand in and you'll kind of feel, you find the bottom of the vertebrae on the inside and you'll kind of feel with your fingers and you just kind of have to work your way through. You'll eventually get your hand all the way around the tenderloin and you can separate that most times with just your hand. If not, just bring your knife in and make some real little cuts, even if you have to go between the vertebrae. You're just kind of going in to kind of undo that part. You'll eventually feel it, getting pretty far up there, getting to the tapered end. You'll work your way back down. Kind of use your fingers as guides, cut really soft. But you'll feel where you get most of the tenderloin out, and all you really need to do is come through here and just kind of make a straight cut and pull it, and you'll be able to start to get your tenderloin out. You'll follow your hand through on the inside and do the same thing, just kind of make a straight cut to cut the back of it, and you can, it's hard where the stomach's there, but you can pull your whole tenderloin out just like that. You can do that with the guts all the way in. A lot of people leave this on the mountain when they do the gutless method, and that's a pretty tasty piece of meat right there. What I like to do, I like to make sure I have a sharp knife. I'm just gonna quickly sharpen it. Any steel, you can get these at pretty much any store. I use a couple different ones. I've got this one, it's a little coarser, and then I also have a ceramic one that's a little bit finer. You don't need the ceramic one, you can do just fine with just one. But what you want to do, I like to measure it with my thumb. You can see my thumb is even on both sides. And I'll use my thumb as the kind of the guide. So I set my thumb down and just keep that same angle. Using my thumb to measure, I can keep it at the same angle every time I swipe. Doesn't matter how slow you go or how fast. I've done it for a long time, so I kind of have a good feel for it. But your biggest thing you want is to make sure you keep that same angle. If you do one angle too sharp, you'll flatten your blade out a little too much. So you just want to keep that flat angle, that same angle, the whole time you're sharpening it. That brings out a pretty sharp knife. All right, so the next step we're gonna do here is we're gonna take that neck meat off. Like I said earlier, this is one of my favorite parts. It makes extremely tender roasts, has a great flavor. The other name for it, I might have mentioned it earlier, but this is your chuck. So when you go to the grocery store and you see a chuck roast, they're one of the better roasts. This is your chuck from a beef cow. This is your chuck area right here. It is one of the more difficult parts to cut off, just because of the different direction of the bones in the neck right there. But I'll pretty much do it the same as the tenderloin. I'll find that middle line where the vertebrae goes, and I'll just stick the knife straight through and just work my knife down right in the middle. There's a tendon that runs right along there, and if you're on one side or the other, or even if you're cutting it in half like I just did, that's fine. The goal is just to peel that neck area back as much as you can. You know, up here you can cut straight through just so it makes it a little bit easier. And then you just work your knife around the bone. I'll be able to show you once we get it out. That bone goes in a few different directions, so it does make it a little difficult. And this neck part of the roast is a little bit flimsier. So as it's not gonna hold tight like your back strap would. So you just kinda have to work it a little bit more. But you'll be able to get it off the same. And it will go down into kind of this chest brisket area. You just kind of keep your knife working against the bone. Keep your knife against the bone for every cut, and just keep peeling that back with your hand. We're already getting a pretty good piece out. If this was, you know, a little bit bigger deer later in the year, and they've put some fat on, some meat on their bones, you know, this would be a pretty dang good roast. Like I've said, your goal is just to keep your knife against that bone as much as you can. Let the bone be your cutting board. That's your chuck roast right there. So in a lot of animals, this will be quite a bit bigger, to where you can cut this in half and make two pretty good sized roasts out of it. Like I said earlier, you can kind of see it's pretty flimsy. There's a lot of different joints and grooves, and not joints and grooves, but connections in there, little different veins of meat. What you can do on those is, once you get it off and be a bit bigger, you can clean cut it in half,
wherever you feel like you need to cut it for a roast for your family, you can tie it. You just tie a string around it, tie it into a ball to hold it together a little bit more while you're cooking. If you want it to just fall apart and shred, make a really good home cooked roast, this is a great cut for it. So the next thing we'll take off on this one, a lot of people leave these, but I talked about it a little bit earlier, the ribs. I am a huge fan of the ribs. You can take it all off with just a knife. I've done it before. It's not very easy, but you can work the tip of the knife through kind of the joints here on the back where the rib bones meet the vertebrae. It's a lot easier with a knife or with a saw. So I'm going to show you kind of how I do it with a saw. You know, you just want to sever all the connections right here. Work your way down. Any pieces of meat that's kind of hanging off and flimsy, this flank area, we can cut this off and come back to it a little bit later. Whether we want to turn it into grind, into fajita, into stew meat, whatever we need to do. Or if you want to leave it as a flank steak style cut. So we'll just cut this one off to get ready to pull the ribs off. Any saw will work. If you're at home, you can use, you know, a skill saw, anything like that up in the mountains. If you can get a saw up there, use it. Like I said, I have done it on an elk with just a knife, separating it at the back joints. It is a bit harder, but it is doable. And I'll do this pretty much last, just to make sure, you know, I get the back strap off. You don't want to be cutting through the back strap. Come off just like that. So I'll go through a little bit later kind of how to clean it up, what you can do to, you know, make them turn out a little bit better. There's a membrane on the backside I can show you how to take off, how you can separate them, and then I'll go through how you can cook them too. So while we've got the deer to this point laying on this side still, I'm gonna go ahead and show you how to take the tenderloin out. If you have it at home, it's hanging, and you can work on it from the inside. What I'm gonna do now, while we have the deer kind of on this side, just so you can see it a lot easier, is I'm gonna show you how to take the tenderloin out from the inside, so you can kind of see what you did doing the gutless method. So as you can see, these are kind of the vertebrae sections that I was talking about that I used as my backboard to cut the tenderloin out. So the tenderloin sits right in this little strip right here. As you can see right here, this piece right here, this little bit darker piece, this is your tenderloin. So what we did is we went in, kind of cut through so it separated it from the bone, got my fingers around it, followed it all the way up to the top, stuck the knife straight through, cut down right there to kind of cut this end off. Then I went in and cut this end off, and we'll do about the same thing right here, just from the inside. So like all the other times before, I try to keep the knife against the ribs, against the bone. Use the bone as the cutting board. Kind of see how I'm working my way up on that again, using those vertebrae sections. It's kind of your backboard, your cutting board. And this is essentially what we did doing the gutless method, just from a different angle. And just kind of work the knife up. Come back, separate it from all the bone you can. Right up here is where we just cut straight through. Keep following it around. Right back here, we just cut straight through. And again, that fits just like that, right into there. If it was on this side, it'd be something kind of like that. What you did on the gutless method is you worked your hand in, got it over the top, got your hand all the way around it, followed it to the front, cut the front off, followed it to the back, and cut the back off. So you can easily get those tenderloins out. We'll trim those up here in a little bit, make them look real nice. But they're kind of fun cut to get out. A lot of people leave them not knowing what they are, but they're a delicious part of the animal. So on the gutless method. I've worked this whole side over. I've taken pretty much everything usable off this side of the deer. There's no reason to leave it on this side anymore. That's when I'll take this and kind of cover it up. You can take it, put it right back on. That protects that whole side. Gives you a chance to grab the deer. Flip it over. And get ready to work on this other side. It's like you're back to square one. All right, so what I kind of explained earlier on, when you're taking the hide off, you don't really have to cut it. You just kind of have to let your knife touch the part. It'll fall off. I'll kind of show you a little bit of a close up on that. This cut back a little bit so the camera can see it a little bit easier. So right here, you can see I'm just kind of pulling on it, and I'll show you. I'm just holding the knife with two fingers. That's all you're really doing. You're not cutting it too sharp. You're just kind of letting the knife do its job. I'm pulling up a lot more with this than I am cutting with the knife. I mean, that's all still with just two fingers to get that taken off. You're not really cutting through stuff, you're just kinda separating that thin skin a little bit easier. Now on the rump, it does hold a little bit tighter. You might need to hold the knife a little bit more, but it's still, I'm not cutting, I'm just kinda removing. It's hard to explain. If you are cutting and you kind of cut into the meat, you know, if you're separating, you cut a good depth into the meat and you feel like you're wasting some, just as quick as you can, get that knife turned back up and get back to the hide so you can start working on there. You're going to cut meat while you're skinning an animal. Everybody does it. Just kind of one of those things that it happens. It's just a matter of getting back to the right spot as fast as you can. You can kind of see on this fat right here, say if that was meat, all I do is just cut pretty much straight through just to get back to that thin skin against the hide, between the hide and the actual meat. When you are working your knife, it doesn't matter if you cut through the hide like this, just as long as you don't mess the meat up too much. And if you do, you just get right back into those cuts. So where to cut it and how to cut it is a little different if you have just an animal to a trophy animal. You will want to try to get an idea of what you're doing before you skin out a trophy animal, because you definitely won't cut down the chest cavity or down that front chest. You'll actually come, you know, around towards the belly button, maybe even give it a little extra room, and you'll actually cut on the spine up to the base of the neck and take it off like a shirt that way. You know, if you are planning on doing a trophy hunt, I recommend getting with the taxidermist that's going to mount your animal and have him explain how he wants you to skin your animal out. They all do it about the same, but they might want it a little different. Some might come skin it for you if you can pack it out. I don't want to speak for them, so. So this next side we're gonna do it as if it was hanging in your garage now. So I'd hang it, you know, from the back feet going down. That's just how I've always done it. You can do the front feet down, just with the head hanging down, it works better for me. So you'll skin it all the way up to the head, get as close to the base of the neck as you can, and then you can do it with a knife, but it is a little bit easier just to take that saw real quick. Cut through that just to get the head and the hide away. You can see if you're doing the boneless method, if you're boning it out, packing it away, you can see right there that's quite a bit of weight. You know, you for a buck hunt, you want to leave the antlers on, leave proof of sex attached to the animal for all your hunts. But that's quite a bit of weight. If you don't need the hide, that's a lot of weight you don't need to be packing out. So what I like to do, we'll say this deer's hanging in your garage at home. The biggest pain in the butt, I think, for cutting an animal up is dealing with the hair. So I've messed with a lot of ways on getting hair off, because I don't want to cut open a pack of steak that I've had cut and it's in the freezer, pull it out, get ready to cook it, and there'll be a ton of deer hair on it. So one of the ways I've found to get the deer hair off is that I really like doing, it seems to work kind of the best for me, is when it's hanging in your garage, just get a wash rag, get it kind of wet, and then you'll pretty much just wipe the hair off. Most of the hair will stick to the wash rag, and it comes off pretty easy. Kind of beats going back later, taking each cut, and trying to wash that individually. You can already see that there's a lot less hair left on the meat of the animal that I've wiped off than there was. You'll always have to go through and just kind of pick a few pieces out, but it's nice to be able to start to just have a nice clean piece just to begin with. And you know, if it's hanging in your garage, you can get pretty much all the meat off to where you might not even have to rinse it off or pick any hair off later. But yeah, so going back to the kind of the bloodshot stuff that I want to get rid of, you can see it's kind of some more damage on here. So even just to start off, I'll get that out of the way. No need to have it right there while we're trying to cut stuff up. You're not going to use it anyways. And we may have to trim it up a little bit more when we get the ribs off. It looks like it's a little deeper, but we'll go back and we'll cut this off again. I'll kind of explain. There's just a little pocket in there. You can do it fairly quick and easy. You just kind of follow that shoulder blade around. I like to leave as much meat on here as I can for the chuck, for that chuck roast, the neck roast. But it comes off just like that, pretty nice and clean. Go back to this hind quarter, do the same thing we did on the other side. Like to kind of get in there and feel where the bone is on that top side. Hopefully you can see it. And again, just work it against the bone. Keep it as close to the bone as you can. Come off just like that. So what we're gonna do here is we're just gonna take the back strap off again. I'll show you again kind of how I do that. So you'll just follow straight in against the backbone. Just angle your knife to cut against the bone as much as you can. If we wanted, in fact, we'll do it this time. I'll cut the whole length of it off. We'll start all the way up at the chuck and we'll end at the back where the sirloin is, to kind of show how it all goes together. and I'm just using that knife against the bone at every chance I have. I'd rather cut the bone than cut the meat. And again, I'm just kind of working my way through there using the bone as the cutting board. Trying to keep my knife on the rib bones throughout the whole process. Back here you got this little bone you gotta remember. But you should be able to take it from the neck all the way through the back strap down like that. I'll put it back on the deer to kind of show you how it fits. You'll take it your chuck section, your ribeye section, your New York section, and a little bit of sirloin there at the end. We can take that and cut that up in a little bit, but it turns out pretty nice. So we're about done with the deer. All we really got to do is take off the last section of ribs, which you saw how simple that was last time. It'll be about the same. Good tasty ribs. All right, so when I'm in the mountains, pretty much all that's left of my deer, because I want the ribs. I like that. I let my dogs chew on the bones. This is pretty much all that's left. You can see how pit clean that is. There's really not much meat left on that animal. This thing right here looks like a chunk of meat. That's just the esophagus. There's really not much more usable meat we could take from this deer. Between this, the feet, and the hide, this is pretty much all I leave on the mountain when I'm done. And a lot of good parts in the deer that are worth taking home and eating. All right, so what we're doing here, we've cut up the deer, we've got it back, we're home. I like to do this part kind of in the kitchen. I've gotten as much hair off of the meat as I can. There'll be little bits, and I'll usually cut that up, or cut the meats up, the steaks up, roast, and then I'll wash those in my sink a little bit later just to rinse any hair on there. If I can just pick it off with my finger, I'll just pick it off. We'll try to go that way. So from what I'm doing here is I'm just trimming. I'm making them into usable cuts. So if you recognize this piece, this is that front shoulder. So this is the end of the shoulder blade. We took it off. I like to pack these out whole like this. There's really not too much bone. They're not too heavy. They're easy enough to pack out heavy. You can usually double these up. Even on an elk, you can double them up and pack them out in one pack. They're not too bad. But what we're going to do is we're going to kind of break it up into usable pieces. I do like my deer hamburger. And so I will set, you know, a fair amount aside for hamburger. And what I do is I just have a bin set to the side just to kind of break that in. So on this cut, so this one is the cross rib roast, is what it's called, you know, in beef terms. But there's a few other cuts to it. So right here's the cross rib roast. Right in here, depending what you want, you can make that part of the roast or flank steak. People do boneless ribs out of it. Over here you have the mock tender, and this is just the shoulder blade. This is the paddle bone. So what I like to do is I'll just kind of trim some of this stuff off and get it ready for hamburger. I don't like too much deer fat in my hamburger. I like my deer hamburger fairly lean. A lot of people will add beef to it later. But what I like to do is I'll just leave it lean, as lean as I can get. And then if I want beef fat later, I'll just have some tallow or lard or something. I'll cook with it. And so that's just kind of one of my personal preferences. That way, when I have it in the freezer, I know it's lean. I can cook with it, add some lard if I want, cook with it and not, or I can always take that out and make that into jerky. When you're making jerky, you don't want fat in jerky. You want to be able to have that as lean as you can. So I've kind of cleaned that up. So what I'm going to do here now, this is kind of where the paddle bone ridge goes down. You can feel it. Hopefully you can see it good enough right through here. It's this white strip right there. So one side curves, one side doesn't. And I'll just kind of run my knife on one side of that. I like to get that outer edge cut out first. And just like we were doing it earlier, I use the bone as the backboard. This cut, there's multiple uses you can do out of it. This is called the mock tender. Looks a lot like a tenderloin. It has a vein of gristle running through the entire cut though. So you can do them as steaks. I've tried them. They turn out pretty good. You know, they're not quite a tenderloin, but they are pretty good. What I like to do is I'll cut this up, and we can actually do that now. I'll cut this up, trim it up a little bit more, cut it up into little medallion steaks that I'll just kind of slow cook, almost like a spare rib type thing. So I'll just kind of take that and cut it straight through into steaks. Take these, cut them in half again. You can see that vein of gristle going right through there. Doesn't really affect it if you slow cook it, you know, it'll be there, but not as good as a tenderloin steak would be. So we'll just kind of leave these paired up and we'll keep cutting on it. So that was your mock tender off one side. So this other side is your flat iron steak. You can do the same cuts like that off of it, or you can cut it into flat iron steaks. Whether you want to do it steak style, you can cut it into fajita. That's really up to you, but they are pretty good cuts. They do have a vein of gristle that does kind of get in the way, and I'll show you how to work around that. So on this one, it sticks to that bone pretty hard. So you want to just work through that bone, keep your knife as close as you can to it, and I'll show you what it'll look like once you get it off that paddle bone. So you can see how clean that turned out on the paddle bone. Very little meat left on there. While we're at it, I'm just gonna cut this back one off too. I like to use this one for fajita. Has a little bit of gristle in it, but you can work around it. It does cook up pretty good. You can kind of see how that comes off. It's just a thin strip. You can throw it in hamburger if you'd like, or we can wrap it up, pair it with some other pieces that are similar, and make that fajita. And while we're here, just separate the bone, see there's very little meat. You can take it and pick a little bit more off that for hamburger. Don't want to waste anything on as much burger as we can get from it. But that's pretty clean. So we'll go back to the flat iron real quick. So the part that is in the actual paddle bone is this part right here. So we'll just kind of isolate that, pull that off the rest of this. Just a thin strip that looks like that. So for this, I'm going to throw on a metal glove. You can do it without, but how thin this one is, I don't want to risk cutting myself. So what you'll do is you'll kind of square up the end, save that for hamburger, and you can kind of see there's the vein of gristle goes straight through kind of that same angle through the whole thing. So what we're going to do is we're going to put the knife right on top of it. We're going to kind of cut at that angle to be cutting that, but we'll cut above it and then we'll flip it over and cut above it again to get that other side off. So best way to do it is just to parallel it up to you. Just kind of bring your knife right along the top of that. You can see these ones are fairly thin, but that's a good little chunk of meat. We'll throw that in with the fajita stuff because these ones are a little thinner than normal. And we'll do the same thing on this side. I'll just use that part, throw it in the hamburger, trim it up a little bit. On an elk, these are pretty good sized, and they do make pretty good steaks. I really like them. On deer, especially a smaller doe like this that we've been working with today, they're great for fajitas. They're a really lean cut, but they have great flavor as well. You can kind of see how that turned out. Really not much to it. This one's fairly thin. On elk, they'll be twice that size at least, and probably one, two of those thick at least. So we'll just kind of go back. It all depends what you want, really. If you want more hamburger, you can always take any of these cuts and put them into hamburger. If you want more fajita, stir fry type stuff, you can do that. We'll just throw this one in a hamburger for the time being. Maybe the other one we'll save up into fajita stuff, but you'll have to cut it into strips to fit it through your grinder later on anyway, so you might as well do it here. For hamburger, I'll pick up as much hair as I can while I'm going at it and just kind of double check it. What we're gonna do next, we're just gonna finish on this cross rib roast, this front shoulder. And like I said earlier, it all depends what you want from the animal. If you want more hamburger, you can cut any of these roasts into hamburger. If you want more stew meat, you can cut any of them into stew meat. I like to leave them as roasts because I can always go back and make them into hamburger. You can't take them from hamburger and turn them into a roast. And so I like to go with the big chunk first because you can always take that roast, cut it down to stew meat, fajita, hamburger, whatever you want. Even thin strips for jerky. But you can't take the hamburger and turn it back to a roast. So I like to leave my portions in the bigger chunks. So what we'll do here is we'll just kind of get it trimmed up a little bit. There's a little bit of the soft stuff, some fat on there that I want to try to get cut off, just so I can save all that for hamburger, make it a good cut. And again, we're going to be working against the bone, and you'll just pretty much cut straight through to get to the bone, and then you'll work all the way around the bone. This one will make a pretty good roast after the fact. One of the perks to knowing where to cut, how to cut, is knowing where to just cut straight through. When I grew up, I was taught how to do this kind of in a different sense, to where you would, and a lot of people, this is how they do it, is you follow the veins of the meat pretty much. You know, wherever there's a soft spot in the meat, you cut straight through there. You follow, you isolate it into those little chunks. Well, that's good, but it's also really nice to know where you can just take a piece and cut it straight through. A lot of people, you know, they'd work a little bit longer trying to get it connected, this piece that I cut straight through, when really you don't need it. All you need to do is just to get it into your manageable size roast. We'll trim it up just a little bit, and it's already looking pretty dang good. And you got a good roast right there. You can tie that one up. It's a little soft like the chuck roast, but that one's a pretty good roast. So as far as the lower legs, some people take it, make stew meat. Those ones I do know, I want hamburgers, so I am going to take those and just cut those lower hocks and lower shanks into a hamburger. I don't really mind how they come off, just as long as I get them off, get them trimmed up or cut down a little bit just to make a manageable size for the grinder that I've got. Just like that, you've taken it from all that meat on the bone. We can put the paddle bone back up so you can kind of see how it fit. But that's your front shoulder we pulled off the deer. That's all you'll have left from it once you cut it down. I'll go ahead and do that front shoulder. Kind of keep with the same groove. Might do this in a little bit faster. So as you can kind of see here, I flipped it over and there's a little bit of bloodshot in this one, probably when it was shot, and some little bit of bruising. I want to try to get that stuff out of there, just because we don't need that attached to the roast when we're cutting up, when we're cooking it and getting ready to eat it. Go back through and cut that mock tender off. You can even do roasts out of that mock tender. Turns out just like that. Trim it up, cut some of the silver skin off of it. Always make that into hamburger. Turns out pretty good. I'll leave that one whole this time. So we'll take this and we'll cut that flat iron off and do it a little different this time, where we're gonna try to leave this triangle of meat onto the big crossrib roast. Again, we'll cut against the bone, stay against the bone. Again, there's your flat iron. We'll trim this up a little bit and then we'll cut it down to those little steaks. We'll add them with the others. Make a good meal of steak or whatever you want to cook out of it. Turns out pretty nice. Flip it over and do the same on this side. Cut that vein of gristle out of there. You can see that turned out pretty good again. And you can see that gristle. I mean, it's not the thickest, but you can see the silver specks, the silver streaks in it. That's your gristle that you don't want to be eating. That's the stuff you just keep chewing and chewing, and it never goes away. Go ahead and cut this back one off. This one did get a little messed up from getting bloodshot and trimming a little extra off, so probably just gonna turn this one into hamburger, which isn't a big deal. That stuff's tasty too. But you can see again, I mean, off that flat iron, there's not much left on the bone. Work would get a little bit more off, but really it came pretty clean. All right, we'll just continue to work on this. This roast right here, clean it up a little bit and get ready. Again, I'm just cutting right through that, the meat, to kind of get to the bone, work around it. All right, so we finished the front shoulders. We're gonna move on to the hindquarters now. There's a lot of cuts you're gonna recognize the name on them. I'll show you where they come from and how to get to them pretty much. So easiest way to start on the hindquarters. I know where everything is. This is the eye of round, bottom round, sirloin tip, inside rounds right here, but I'll show those when we get there. This little streak right here, there's no bone, there's nothing right there. That's where I like to start. There's a good crease right in there where you can separate two of the main cuts, and then that's just always my good starting point is right here in this little crease. Hopefully you can see it well enough, but we'll go ahead and start there. And when I'm cutting into it, I really just start just by cutting in. I'll take the glove off so I can feel, and you can see. I mean, I barely scored the top of that with the knife, and you can already see how deep and how separated it already is right there. You just kind of work along that point, and the cuts that we're working on right here is your bottom round. It's also known as the rump roast, as you'd see it at the store. It's a really good cut, really lean, makes great roasts. We'll start pulling that one off here. And once you get into here, you're just kind of following the grooves. There's a few spots where it's nice to know just to cut straight through. Nice to know, you know, which pieces are what. But as far as that goes, you're really just cutting straight through. So what I just cut off, that's the bottom round, but the eye of round is also attached. This is one of the leaner parts. It shrinks up. It's kind of a tight roast, so I like to make jerky out of mine. And what you'll do is you pretty much follow the seam and cut it away. Right at the top of it, you will have to make a cut. Looks like there's a little bit of blood shot, but pretty much just cut that in away. It's just a single round roast. A lot of people take these and make them into steak just because it's lean. It looks like a good cut. You can just cook into a steak, but it is a really tough cut. We'll trim that up here in a second. I don't know if we can do that now. It is a really, really tough cut. It's really lean. Doesn't have much marbling in it. What I'm doing right now is just cutting off the bloodshot stuff as close to the bruising as I can see, so I don't waste any of it. And then if it looks good enough, I'll throw that into hamburger. I'll just kind of square up the ends. Take any hairs off I find. Just have that hamburger nice and clean. And I'll pair this one up with the one from the other side, and I'll wrap it up just like that, and I'll label it as eye of round roast. And we'll take that, and you can make jerky out of it. It's a pretty good cut. So what I'll do here is I'm just trimming up this rump roast, taking as much of the fat off, throw the fat and keep the meat off that. I like to cut the silver skin. The silver skin can be pretty dang tough at times, so I like to get it off the roasts. Trim some of this fat off the back. Alright, and that right there, depending, you know, how big your family is, how big you want it. It's fairly small on this dough, but on an elk you can cut 4 big roasts out of that bottom round. We'll leave this whole. For me that's a good sized roast. So that come out of that's the rump roast. Next cut we'll work on this one is the sirloin tip roast. It kind of hugs the bone. That one's kind of a unique one. You have to find where the knuckle is, the joint, and you'll just kind of cut through, find the inside of the bone, and get down to the bone. And this one, this cut is going all the way around the bone. So you just kind of have to work your knife, peel it back, cut right above the joint on the bottom side. You'll kind of go at an angle on the top side, not get rid of your sirloin. But you'll just cut it away from hugging that bone. Get to a spot back here. And you just kind of cut through. Hugs most of that bone. You can see kind of how far around I went. This back part right here is the inside round. This is your sirloin. We'll get to that in a minute. But right now we'll trim up this sirloin tip. So there's a little bit of bruising. I'll get that stuff cut off. Don't want that in my hamburger. This stuff looks good. We'll keep that for hamburger. So now I'll just kind of trim it up. Make it look nice. I'll clean some of this silver skin. If you can peel it off like this layer, you can go ahead and toss that layer. If it's too attached to meat, you can go ahead and grind that. As long as you have enough other lean meat with the hamburger, you don't have to worry about it. So, and that doesn't do it justice, but on a deer, it's really small. An elk, it's still not the biggest, but that right there is a tri-tip. Comes right on the end of the sirloin tip. I cut the top off just a little bit, but on deer there really isn't much to it. You can save that, try to make stew. It's still a good cut, but with the size of it, I'll probably just make that right into hamburger. I mean, tri-tips are usually pretty good size, but that's what that one is. So if you've ever been curious of where the tri-tip comes from, it's from that hindquarter section of the animal. So elk are even pretty small, but deer, they're very small. So with this roast, it's already trimmed up. It's good to go. It's a good looking roast. If you'd like, you can cut it in half. For an elk, you can actually cut this big side off and make some good lean, pretty good steaks out of it, the silver side steaks. But for this one, we're just gonna leave it about that size. It's a good size cut, good size roast. All right, we're gonna come up here to the sirloin real quick. This is your sirloin steak. If there wasn't a bone in the way, this would be connected at the very end of the back strap. So it'd go chuck at the front, ribeye, New York, and then right at the very end is your sirloin steak. So those make pretty good steaks. They're not huge on a deer, but they're big enough to make a pretty good steak. I'll cut as much of the fat off, trim it up a bit, and then we'll cut these into steaks real quick. I'll square it up, and then just cut straight through into steaks. And these ones do turn into pretty good steaks. I really enjoy them. You can see they turn out a little bit of gristle, but still a really good cut. All right, the next one we're gonna move into is the inside round. Make a lot of different stuff with that. You can get top round steaks from it. I usually just do roasts from it. So again, we'll just kind of cut at the knuckle, cut it away from the bone. Use the bone as your cutting board. We'll come back and take the rest off that later. So this cut, more than any other cut in the animal probably, is the one that kind of gets, put it the right way, it gets beat up when people are processing it and butchering it. This is the part right in here that when you cut through that hind section of the deer when you're gutting it, this is the part that gets exposed. You will usually lose a little bit of meat off this, and that's okay. But this is the part, you know, somebody guts it and then they drag it out. This is the part that gets covered in dirt. They quarter it out, you know, it gets kind of tore up. And just given where it's at, it's going to happen. So if you get home and you get cutting it up like this and you get to this part and it just looks rough, that's completely normal. This is, if any part was to look kind of rough, it would be this part right here. And what I like to do is I just trim it up, because, you know, that is where you've gutted it. Stuff from the insides may have come out that way, and I don't want that in my hamburger, in my roast. So I do trim this one a little more generous than the rest, just to make sure we get it nice and clean. I'll just kind of visually inspect it, you know, make sure it doesn't look too rough. Make sure it's nice and clean. You know, you don't want to see anything from the guts coming into it, and it's looking pretty good. So this one, you can just make a pretty good roast. Cut it into stir fry, cut it into steaks if you'd like, but that and I like to just leave as a good looking roast. It'll cook right and turn out good. So we'll just carry on. The rest of it is pretty much just hamburger off this back shank, and so we'll cut this off and moving on to the next side. We'll just move on back to the next side. I'll do it pretty much the same way. I'll make that little cut right there. You can see how simple that was. I mean, I just flick of the wrist, and you can reach in there and feel quite a bit of room inside of that cut. Get rid of some of that silver skin. Follow it down. You can see where the line of meat is. You really just have to cut in front of that. You don't have to cut it hard, just kind of score it to get that start given. Because if you go too deep, there is another cut underneath it. Make sure we come up, get the eye around. Trim it up again. Don't want too much fat in the deer fat in there. We'll cut this eye round off. Looks good. Go back, trim up the bottom round roast again. Get that going. Get rid of that silver skin. It's always easier to get it off when you're already out cutting everything else than when you're ready to cook dinner and you get your steak, you get your roast thawed out and you're ready to start cooking because you're getting hungry and you got to trim it up more. It's always easier to trim it up and get it all the way ready right now than it is to kind of get it halfway ready, get it kind of prepped and be like, oh, I'll finish trimming it right before I cook. I can always do that, but I found it's just so much easier just to get the job done the first time instead of having to fix your roast, trim it up a little bit right before you go to cook it. So got that rump roast off again. Pretty good looking roast. I'll leave that whole again. I'll match it up with the other side. Go back to the deer. We'll cut the sirloin off again. And again, this kind of knee right here, you pretty much just cut straight through. Follow it back in, back to the bone, and that sirloin is kind of hugging that bone right there. Hopefully you can see that. Pull it off so we don't. I'll show that tri-tip again. I often forget about that tri-tip just because on deer there isn't really much to it, but I'll show you kind of where it's located on that hind quarter. That roaster's right here, sirloin tip. Right here is your tri-tip. That right off. You got your sirloin tip again. A little bit of hair and bruising on this side. We'll get that cut off. Don't need that in the hamburger. But yeah, it already is a pretty good looking piece of roast. match it with this other side and get back in here, and we'll cut the tri-tip and the sirloin off now. Like all the other times I've said before, you use your bone as the backboard. Cut against the bone instead of against the steak. So as you're looking at it, this part right here, this is your sirloin right here, and this is your tri-tip. You see, it's a little bit bigger than that other one I showed you was. I cut the top off that other one, but it's really not too big on these deer. So we'll go ahead and get those separated. Trim up the sirloin first. Kind of beat up on the backside, but we'll manage. So the sirloin, you know, it's good to cut into steaks. You can do all of that. But what I've done a couple times with it, it turns out pretty good, is I'll leave it whole. This one's a little bit small, but I'll leave it whole, almost like a roast. But I'll cook it on the grill, kind of a medium rare, season it, take it off the grill, let it rest for a little bit, cut it up into steaks at that point, and it turns out pretty good. Has a lot of flavor. But yeah, you can do pretty much anything with the sirloin. They're a good cut. I'll cut some more steaks out of it so we can get some more steak. You can see they turn out pretty good, even on a small one. So I'll finish up with this tri-tip. This little end right here, that's just grind. Cut a little bit of the fat off of that. Turn that up. And just on deer, once you trim this up, there's really not too much left to it. We'll try to save some on this, and we'll package it and label it as a tri-tip on this one. This whole deer that we've got and we're processing today is actually going to be donated to somebody that needs it. So it'll be kind of nice. Package it up, start to finish for them. Go back to the leg. I'll keep taking off this inside round. Just kind of follow the grooves, follow the seams, cut against the bone. Sometimes you can just hold it and let the weight of the roast work for you. So again, like I said earlier, you can see where that one's kind of rough out here on top, you know, a lot of hair, a lot of stuff. We'll get all that cleaned up. It's a lot easier to clean now than later. And anything I want to trim up more, I'll just set to the side and I'll get it later. This is the stuff that I want to trim off and not use. It's, like I said, this is the part of the deer that kind of, it's right there at the back end that when you're gutting it, stuff comes out, may rub against the meat, and you don't want that in your roast, don't want that in your hamburger. So, that bottom part looks pretty clean. Here we are. I'll trim it just a little bit more, just make it look nice. So yeah, like I said, when I did that other side, this is the part that gets beat up. So I trim this pretty well. I want to get all that stuff that may have been touched by the guts when you're gutting the animal, if you do that method. You know, if it gets drug in the dirt, I like to trim it off, make it look nice. You know, if there's anything that's looking brown or off color, just go ahead and cut that off. It's not a big deal. You want to make sure this is a good clean piece of meat, and you can see it's turned out pretty good. I'll come back to this, and this one, you know, the top looks a little off-colored in my book, so I'll only trim this backside. We'll probably toss this the rest. Like I said, it's not worth. You can kind of see the discoloration right here on top. I don't know if you can see it better over here. It's not worth having that in your hamburger, so. So I'll just finish up this one, cutting the rest of the shank off. Cutting all this meat in a hamburger. We've already got one bowl about almost filled. It's looking pretty good. We'll get probably about 15 pounds of hamburger off this deer, which will be nice. and get as much of that meat off the bone as I possibly can. I don't want to let any of that go to waste. This is some good meat, so. I will try to avoid the tendons in the hamburger. Some of the tendons can get pretty thick. This one right here, you can kind of see that one's, that's pretty thick. I don't really want that in the hamburger, so I won't cut that one into it. Some of these ones back here get a little thick. I'll trim those off if I need to. Go from there. It's pretty trimmed up. Not much meat left on there. All right, so from there, let's jump into the tenderloins. I'll clean up the tenderloins real quick. I'm going to move this over here, give it a little bit of space. All right, we'll go ahead and move to the tenderloins. Where they are located inside the animal, if I'm gonna leave it and let it hang for quite a while, like I talked about earlier, I do like to let take the tenderloins out, just because they're pretty exposed. You know, you can't leave the hide covering those. They're kind of in there by the gut, so I do like to try to take care of those fairly quick. But even all the bloodshot stuff, you don't want that in the tenderloin. You trim it up to make it look and taste real good. So you can tell it's an extremely tender piece of meat, and you can tell even from cutting it right here, you can tell by how soft it is. It doesn't take much to cut right through the tenderloin. And so you have to be careful not to over trim that one. You have to be real, real smooth to try to get, you know, some of that bloodshot stuff off, where you don't want to cut too much of the tenderloin off. But yeah, so in the grocery store, I mean, I'm sure you've probably heard tenderloin, but another name for it you've probably heard is the filet mignon. That's when they cut this, and this is what the filet mignon comes from. It's not big on some of the deer, but that's still a dang good piece of meat. I'd cook it on the roast just like that, seasoned it up. You know, I'm a fan of medium rare. Season it up, cook it, and it'd be a pretty tasty piece. Let me get this other one trimmed up. See on that, and that turned out to be a pretty good piece. That one's a little bit longer. I can't remember which one came from the boneless method. I'm thinking this is probably the one we could see. We could cut down to this tip a little bit better, but really not much difference. One was done with the boneless method, the other one was done by seeing the inside. Alright, so while we're here, I'll just come back to some of those thinner pieces that I cut off the deer. Now, if you can get to it pretty quick, these thin pieces around the stomach, you know, some of the flank steaks and stuff, they can turn into some pretty good cuts of deer. This one, it was frozen. It was shot a few days ago, but it was frozen, so it kind of dried out. So I'll likely just trim it and turn it mostly into hamburger. Just given how it looks to me, you know, We'll decide if I get into it and I like how it looks, but it's likely just going to turn into hamburger. And this part came from right below the ribs, kind of where, covering the softer part of the stomach. So This one's not too thick, so we'll leave that to hamburger. On an elk that gets pretty thick, and you can make, you know, some good skirt steak and stuff out of that. But on this steer's a little thinner. Go from there, trim it up a little bit, make sure it's nice and clean. So these are more of these belly parts. We'll just trim those up and get them looking good. All right, yeah, so these are the belly parts. Just trimming it up. This one turned out pretty nice. This is very similar to a flank steak. This is what you'd cook into it. It's a little different on a deer from a cow because there's not as much marbling as there would be on a flank from a cow. But you can still cook it very similar, you know, cutting it in strips, fajitas. You can do, you know, a quick little sear on the grill and then cut it into strips. They make pretty good little strips of meat there. All right, we're moving on to the back strap now. So I'll just get this trimmed up. I like to clean this silver skin off the top. This is some pretty thick stuff. So we'll go ahead and clean that up. You have to be careful up here on the ribeye side of things because you don't want to over trim it and get rid of that good meat that sits on top of that ribeye cap. And I'll explain that to you here when I get down into it. So we've got about one bowl full of hamburger filled up. We'll start working on the next one. Top layer, the silver skin, you can pull most of it off. But we will trim up that bottom part and trim that off as well. So when you're trimming the silver skin off, it's thicker than you think. You can cut your knife almost right into it, and it won't go through, but it'll cut and separate from the meat. You can see how steep I'm angling that knife. And you can see there's very little meat left on there. If you were to skin the deer before, going back to, you know, the skinning protects the meat, you'd have to cut this off plus, you know, another quarter inch of the back strap off, but sometimes you have to, and that's fine too. But you can see on there that there's not much meat left on that thing. You don't have to deal with that gristle and stuff on top of that silver skin when you go to cook it. You just stick your knife through and angle it up almost like you're cutting the silver skin, but don't press too hard and your knife will just glide right along that edge. And it won't cut through it. I'll go through the different styles to how you can cut the back straps. Everybody does it a little bit of a different way. Some people like to butterfly it. I'll show you that one, all that method. I like to just cut them thick instead of butterflying it. I'd rather have a real thick steak than, you know, a little bit bigger, thinner one. You know, I know some people that'll even leave the whole back strap whole. They won't cut it all, and they'll do it. I actually did this last year. We cooked it up on the grill, a whole back strap, and then cut it almost like you would a prime rib or something. Cook it really low and slow, and then just take little steaks off as you go and eat it like that. So there's a lot of different ways you can do the back strap. Once I get it trimmed up, I'll we'll start going through those, and we're about there. Make sure that back is trimmed, and you can see, you know, that's came off pretty clean off those ribs. Very little I gotta trim. Square up the end, get a good start for steaks. And we'll start cutting. So your first normal cuts, you can just go just your straight, cut straight through, you know. I'll kind of give an example. I'll cut enough steaks of each one to kind of make a pack for the family we're donating this animal to. So, you know, about an inch thick, just straight through. Nice and easy. They turn out pretty good, you can see. So pretty good looking steaks there, just single steaks. I'll show the butterfly method now. So to butterfly it, you want to measure like you're cutting the first steak, but you don't cut the whole way. You cut through on the second cut. So I want my steak to be about, you know, about an inch thick. I'll cut through, but leave about a quarter of an inch on the bottom where I don't. And then that second cut, I'll measure it about an inch. I'll cut all the way through there. What that does is, so when I cut it, I can fold it out. Might need to touch it just a little bit to get it lay perfectly flat. But you can see that steak turns out into a little bit bigger steak than the ones if you just cut it straight through. This is the butterfly, and this is just your normal steak. Cut a few more butterflies. And you can package them. Butterflied, you can have them set on the edge, but pretty good stack of steak right there. All right, I'll just finish out this last one. Just normal steaks, a little bit thicker. We're starting to get into the ribeye cut, so I'll show you that for a little bit. So you can kind of see, I'll use these two as an example. So just so you know, for like grocery store purposes, like when you go to the store and buy a ribeye steak to a New York steak, so the New York is just further up. The main difference you can see is this is your New York. This is all just straight, lean, no veins, nothing. This is gonna be your ribeye. See how this kind of has this top cap? As we go further down, this will actually cover the whole thing. This one will have a little bit more marbling inside of it. Might be a little more tender than the New York, but they both have great flavor, especially on a deer. But that's your main differences, and that's why this one will look a little bit softer, floppier you could call it, than this one's that's just a solid piece of meat. And I'll just finish cutting that the rest of the way into steaks. And there'll be a couple of them are a little rough looking. But those turn into some pretty good steaks. They look a little rough, but they're, I love them. All right, we'll move to this next one that has the chuck attached to it. So if you remember, this is the one, the chuck up here, New York down here. So when we cut the whole length, and if we had those sirloins still that I've already cut, they would attach right on the other side of this bone that goes right here, sitting right here. So that's from head to tail, pretty much that main muscle part of the deer. So I'm gonna trim up some of this bloodshot stuff real quick. So again, I'm just going in here, cutting against the silver skin. Angle the knife against it. Comes off pretty good, pretty clean. Some people, you know, if you don't want to do it like this, you can cut your steaks first and then trim it up. In fact, I'll save these first couple steaks and I'll do it that way, show you another option. I like to trim it off the whole thing at first, just because that's what I've always done. It seems to go faster for me. But that backside looks good. It's trimmed up nice and good. And just start cutting this. So the first couple, and I'll cut about an inch thick and I'll show you how to do that. You'll just lay them flat and then you'll just trim right off. I feel like sometimes you take a little more meat on it just because you can't cut against that silver skin. But you know, if you don't feel like you're ready to cut the silver skin like I showed you, this definitely is the safer method if you're worried about cutting too deep into the roast or into the steaks. Cut four more steaks there. I'll get some butterflies again. Let's see again, those turn out pretty good. What I'm gonna do on this one, just so we can have a few different varieties, I'm gonna leave this one a loin roast. Now you'll cook this up, you know, on the grill, kind of to a medium rare. You can slow cook it in the oven, and then you just kind of cut off the top and cut off from the front down. It turns out to a really good cut. I really, really like eating that one. So this one we'll carry over to this one too. But this is the rest of the this is the chuck. This one's a little bruised. We'll see how bloodshot it looks in here. It's looking a little rough, as you can kind of see. So what I'm gonna do with this one is I'm just gonna trim it up, cut around those parts, and put that into hamburger. You know, I'd rather I like the hamburger, and I'd rather have it turn out good than turn out do a roast that has some of that bloodshot stuff in it and just turn out overly gamey and not very appetizing. So we'll go ahead and trim some of these hairs, some of the hair off. So you can see real good right here, all that bloodshot in there. Now that was kind of inside the roast, so if you were to just cut it, not paying attention to that, you'd actually tie that into your roast, and it, when you go to eat it, it just tastes a lot gamier. So it's better safe than sorry to just get that stuff out, make this one a little bit more hamburger, than to have that really gamey, not as good roast into the mix. This chuck roast looks a lot better. Now you can see it's pretty thin. We'll still trim it up. I'll probably fold it in half and possibly tie it to try to get that good roast out of it. But it's already pretty well trimmed up. You can see it's pretty sloppy, and by that I mean it's it moves a lot. It's not a firm piece of meat, you know, something like this. It moves a lot, so that's why I like to tie it up and do it that way. It's about ready, so we'll go ahead and move these over to our table, and then we'll finish up with the ribs. All right, so we're gonna finish up here. We're gonna get these ribs cut up, broken down into manageable pieces. So what I like to do, there's a lot to the ribs that you just don't need on here. There's a little bit of fat, you know, the little bit of meat down here. That was around the guts while you were gutting your animal, cleaning it up. So I like to just cut that off and just kind of clean it up, get it ready to work with. You know, some of this stuff you don't really need on here. Some of it gets kind of thin and dry, you know, if you've packed it out for an hour, it'll dry out. You can kind of see how it's starting to get pretty dry right here. We'll get that trimmed up, and you can see where this deer was shot right here. So I won't really even mess with right here. I'll probably just cut these two ribs off. Just like so. And they're bloodshot, they're thin, they're the small ones. We don't need to mess with them, so we'll just cut those ones clean off. We'll get the rest ready to work with. Square some stuff up. They're looking pretty good. I'll get this one. I'll trim up the other one, then we'll get it wiped down. This one again has the stuff on the inside you don't really need. This one's pretty bloodshot anyway, so we'll just cut those ones off. We don't need that stuff right there. Front part. Clean these up. Square them off. And you can see this one's really bloodshot. We're going to be removing a lot of this off. Anything that looks clean, we'll put into hamburger. All this bloodshot, bruising stuff that's going on, we'll just get rid of that. We don't need that in our hamburger. I don't know if we're gonna get much from this side of the rib. You can already see, you know, I've trimmed a lot of the meat back, and we're already into this. This is pretty bruised, so there really isn't much left after trimming that up. So, and that's kind of what happens with the ribs. Most of the time you're shooting your deer in the chest anyways, you're gonna break some of the ribs. But if you can save some, I like to, but this one is, you can see that's pretty bloodshot. So we're gonna focus on this other side of them. We'll call this one an attempt. All right, so once you get it trimmed up, your ribs, there's a membrane on the back that you wanna try to get off. It's kind of a pain to get off a little bit, but what you wanna do, and you do this with all ribs, not just deer ribs. You buy pork ribs at the store. You want to take the membrane off. This will make any rib that you cook a little bit better. So you'll just kind of stick your knife. A butter knife works really well. You don't want something too sharp, but you just kind of work under that edge. These ones might be too sharp right now. You just work underneath the rib just enough to get your finger in there. And you'll actually peel that really thin membrane off of all the ribs. This one's pretty thin. We'll see what we can do. A little bit bigger deer, they'd be a little bit thicker. We'll try to start from this side. You'll find the ribs, they'll turn out a little more tender, a little juicier, have a little more flavor if you can get this membrane off. And this one might just be a little too thin. I think that might be about all we're gonna get on this one. Ah, spoke too soon. All right, so that's actually quite a bit of that little membrane. So what we'll do is we'll cut it up into the different chunks. Now, ribs aren't just ribs. You can cook them whole, but that's kind of quite the plate of ribs inside of your crock pot or something. And how I like to do them to get them turn out pretty good, I told you earlier, they're when you cook them, they're gonna smell extremely gamey. At least my experience, they've always smelled really gamey to the point where it's like, I don't know if I wanna eat this. It's that strong. Well, what I do is I'll cook them in the crock pot, some apple juice, some barbecue sauce on it. If I can, sometimes they end up being too tender, but if I can, I'll pull them out, put them on a tray, sear some barbecue sauce on it, just broil it in the oven real quick, throw it on the grill, just to kind of get that good caramelization and the good crisp on it. But it's going to smell real gamey, but this is, no joke, one of the best tasting pieces of deer I've ever had is the ribs. If I could choose, you know, a good rack of ribs from a deer over backstrap, I would probably choose it. It's dang good stuff if you cook it the right way. Gets a bad rep, smells really gamey, but it's actually really delicious. So when you separate them, you can do it however you'd like. And if you follow this way, you know, this is kind of what it is in the store. So right through here, this top part is your baby back ribs. This bottom part is kind of your slab style. So I like to just kind of cut it right there, so I got, you know, good meat on top of this. I'll usually cook both of them at the same time, but just kind of separate it a little bit more. So if I can get my help to cut, I'll just use a saw. A saw's all works really well with it. Okay, and finish it out like that. I package them, fold them over each other, package them just like that, but they are actually really, really good. I really enjoy deer ribs, so elk ribs are just as good. So even if I've got to pack it out from quite a ways, up in the mountains, you know, I'll get all the big meat out, and all people will laugh at me and judge me, but I'll even take the time and take as many ribs as I possibly can out, just because I love looking forward to the meal having the ribs. Yeah, we'll get on to the packaging now. All right, so most people know how to package their stuff for the freezer, but I've kind of got a cool trick that I like to show. A lot of people vacuum pack it. It's a little time consuming. Some it can get expensive if you don't already have the gear and equipment. What I like to do, saves a lot of time and keeps you clean. I can cut all this, what I normally do at my house, I can cut all this, and while I'm cutting each chunk, my wife's wrapping the stuff. And you can do this without getting your hands dirty. I mean, I don't have gloves on now, but you take just bread bags, turn them inside out, use those as your glove. We'll just go ahead and grab this sirloin tip, take it, turn it inside out. That way you can press all the possible air out of there. Give it kind of a good twist to seal it, roll it over, and package it. So the reason I like to do this is for to save your meat for a long time, even for, you know, a good year. Your enemy is air, contact with air. So if you have it sealed like this, covered, you won't get freezer burn as much. If you were to just put it in a Ziploc, can't quite get all the air squirrels out of that Ziploc, you might get freezer burn spots wherever there's air in there. But doing it like this, you can package any steak, any roast. The ribs get a little hard, but you can squeeze all the air out of there. I mean, you can zoom in and see there's very little air inside this. My hands are clean. I can put it in the paper, wrap it, not worry about getting blood all over the butcher paper. Still have a free hand, clean hand to grab some tape, freezer tape. Take it, fold it over. Seal it up nice and good and be able to label it, all without getting your hands messy and dirty. So doing it like this, you can store meat in a freezer for, I've never had any of my stuff really go freezer burn. It gets eaten too fast, but you know, over a year you could probably get away with storing it packaged like this, just because your enemy is the air, contact with the air. So I really like that trick. I like sharing it with people. So just to finish up, after watching this processing video, you know, it's nice to know how to do all this stuff yourself. Given a year like we've had this year, you know, meat packing houses being closed down at certain times, I know a lot of the local butcher shops are actually a little too busy right now, and they may not take as many big game animals as they could in the past. And kind of a fun thing to know about this, and the way I look at it, is when I get a tag and I go hunting, I'm the one that goes out, I hunt it, I harvest my animal, I, you know, gut, quarter, clean, bring it home, I cut it up, I wrap it, I usually cook it. I've been the only one to touch all of the steak that I eat, all the roast that I eat at my house, and it's nice for me to know where exactly my meat's coming from. I know that it's healthy, you know, it's been taken care of, that I don't have to worry about, you know, if it's been kept clean, you know, and through all the different steps that they take at a meat packing house. I know exactly what this deer has gone through from eating in the field to dinner on my table. It's kind of nice for me to know. And really, when you start out, it looks a little intimidating. A lot of people are like, I don't want to mess with that. It's really easy. Once you get going, I even have to remind myself, you know, first couple times I do it in the year, what's what. But once you get the hang of it, once you remember, I mean, you remember from the shapes and location. I mean, you know where the back strap, but as far as the chuck, you know, you remember that up in your neck. The rump roast, the eye of round, everything on that butt portion of the animal. You start remembering where that's out, and then it just all of a sudden clicks, and you're like, oh, this is, I just cut right here, and it makes it so much easier, so much faster, and you can get, you know, your whole animal processed in one evening, and have time to have dinner with the steak afterwards. So it seems like a lot to bite off, but it's actually really easy. And, you know, I encourage others to try this, start to finish, you know, field to table. You know, it's something that I think everybody can do. So good luck.